church, everybody. Why don't you all stand up as we praise the Lord. Amen. So different, and the thing that binds us, which is Jesus died on the cross for our sins, for you and I, that we could have eternal life, that we could live with him. Amen. And so this day is not just another day. This is a day that we can really remember that, we can meditate on that, we can think about that, and how powerful that is, and what great sacrifice Jesus Jesus did for us, that he could have relationship with you, that he could have relationship with me. Amen. And so I just really encourage you that as we sing these songs, as we worship God, and then when we hear from Derek a bit later on, that we would just remember the amazing sacrifice that God made and spend some time thinking about that.
Come with glory. mic? Oh, yes, my mic is on. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Praise your name. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, wonderful. Thank you, worship team. That was absolutely fantastic. I can really sense the Lord is hovering over this place. So. Ah, got goosebumps. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thanks, guys. Yeah, take a seat. Okay. All right, so first up, why am I here? all right, just to let you know that yesterday Nita had a COVID test, and at about midnight last night they got the results, and the result was that Nita was positive for COVID. So Nita and Wayne are now in isolation for the next 7 days. So he sent me his message. And I'm going to do my best to bring it justice. We'll see how we go. But before we do that, I just want to say a couple of announcements, okay, and then we'll just have a prayer for Wayne and Nita. But tonight there's a ladies' meeting, 7 o'clock. My wife's going to be doing something. Ah, there, yeah. You don't want me, because if I was there, it wouldn't look like a cross by the time you'd finished it. It'd look, who knows what it'd look like. But my wife can take two flowers and stick them in a vase and make them look absolutely fantastic. I can stick two flowers in a vase and they look like two flowers in a vase, both going in different directions. But see, a talent. You've got to have a talent. She's got a talent. So, and the other thing I want to tell you about is men. We're going to have a barbecue on the 30th, Saturday the 30th. It's out at Stewie's place. Out at Gundaroo. Yeah, that's it. I was going to say Gungahlin, but it's a bit further than Gungahlin. It's out at Gundaroo. So the men's group will supply all the drinks and food and what have you. So the first one for the day, for the year, is going to be cost neutral to all you guys. So come on out. We'll have a bit of a fire or something and we'll do that. So she'll be good. So let's just, if you'd all like to bow your heads, let's just pray for Nita and Wayne. So Lord, we just lift up our pastor to you, Pastor Wayne and his wife Nita. Lord, that Father God, that this COVID virus, Lord, would just come and go. Lord, there be no lasting effects, Lord, that you would just bring them through safely, Lord, that you would bring healing to their bodies, Lord. So we thank you, Father God, that you are, Lord, control over everything, Father God. You are in it, Lord. So, Lord, we just lift them up to you, Father, and ask that you just do only what you can do, Lord. So thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So the message this morning is on we must be born again. Okay, so now that is, I think, a very fundamental foundation for Christianity. You must be born again. And it's, the word in the Bible says must. Okay, now I'll tell you a little story, a bit embarrassing for me, but I'll tell you the story anyway. When I first joined the public service, I was in what was called Australian Construction Services, and I learned a very early lesson about the word must. They let me loose on a contract, which was, considering I'd never touched a contract in my life before, was a bit dangerous, I guess. But we built a, I think the at Rathbase Richmond, an ablutions block. Bruce knows what an ablutions block is. And when the contractor had finished and said, okay, here it is, it's all yours, you can have it, we went to have a look, as one does. And when we went into the ablutions block, have a guess what wasn't there? Toilets. Okay. There was no toilets. There was nothing. There was just a building. Okay, there was holes in the floor and partitions up, but we'd forgotten one word, must. And he looked at it and said, well, it's obviously, it's not a must. It's just maybe it's, you know, it's something that you would like to have, but you haven't said that you must have it, so I haven't done it. And the contract was perfect. He was well within his rights. The contract didn't say you must put them in. It was an oversight. Yes, desirable. Yes, yeah. Desirable, but not must. There was an oversight, simple, but cost an arm and a leg to get those musts in there. As a lesson I learned real quick, make sure you, when you're doing a contract, that if there's a must in there, that if you want something, you've got to put it as a must. Yeah, you must put it in, okay, the word must. And Jesus has put that word in, must. You must be born again, okay? Now, this born again thing is what will determine your eternal destination. Okay, you must be born again. If you're not born again, then you're not going to get to heaven. Quite simple. And what's the alternative to heaven? Hell. And hell is not a very nice place. And Jesus tells us that in Scripture. Now, if hell didn't exist, Jesus wouldn't have mentioned it, okay? And he does. He tells us all about it. Fire and brimstone and gnashing of teeth and all sorts of things. So it's a must that you must be born again. See, and I've already said that it's a fundamental truth. It's something that our whole faith is built upon. The idea that you must be born again, that you can be born again. Jesus tells us that, that's the way to go. And if you're not born again, then sadly to say, if you die in ignorance, or you, well, maybe not even ignorance, people, there's enough, I think, people know about the Scriptures enough, I would hope. Although a couple of generations now where children have, unless the parents bring their children to church, they don't hear it at school anymore. You know, unless they go to Sunday school, they don't hear it. And if parents don't teach their children about the Scriptures, then they are ignorant and they will fall away. There is no second chance. If you do not accept Jesus and his offer of eternal life and his offer of being born again while you are still breathing, okay, then there is little chance for you. Now, I don't know, and I refuse to judge anybody. I believe that at any point of time, Jesus can come to a person and say, here I am. Do you believe me now? I mean, I look at the thief on the cross. He had no time. He didn't do any good works. In fact, he was being crucified for bad works. He wasn't a very nice man. But Jesus said to him, that thief on the cross called Jesus Lord, he said to him, today you will be with me in paradise. Okay, so right up to the last possible second, Jesus can come and he can reveal himself to any person. Okay, so I'm not going to judge anybody because I don't know. And I won't know until I get to heaven and then I go, oh, look who's over there. I didn't think he'd get in. Oh, slap you down. You know, but, you know, it's... So you've got to be very careful. We're told not to judge, so don't judge by, you know, because Jesus can do that. But if you are so stubborn that you absolutely refuse to take the offer that Jesus gives us, then I'm sorry to say, you're going to end up in hell. But God is merciful. You know, and what Scripture tells us that God doesn't want anybody to perish. So he's given everybody the opportunity to come to know Jesus. And this is, the Scripture that we're going to look at is in John 3:3-8. And it says, this is Nicodemus. Okay, we all know he's a Pharisee, okay, and he's come to Jesus. And Jesus says to him, and Jesus answered and said to him, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." He cannot enter the kingdom of God. "That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is everyone who is born of the Spirit." You know, this is a special time for the Christian faith. This is Easter. We celebrate. We call it Good Friday. My wife said to me this morning, "Why do we call it Good Friday? Why don't we call it Terrible Friday or Horrible Friday?" We call it Good Friday because the good thing is that we have salvation. Had Jesus not died, we would not have salvation. So it is a Good Friday. Everything God turns to good for those that love him, okay? So it's a Good Friday because it gives us the opportunity to come before God, repent, say we're sorry, ask him into our lives and receive our eternal destination. So this Nicodemus now, he wasn't just an ordinary person, okay? He was a member of the ruling council. He was schooled in the Jewish tradition. He was schooled in the Jewish Torah, the Old Testament. So he knew lots of things. He wasn't just a run-of-the-mill person. But even he didn't understand what Jesus was talking about. You must be born again. Without that born-again experience, you will not see heaven. But the thing is that Jesus isn't just talking to Nicodemus. He's talking to you and to me, okay? The you is you. It's not just Nicodemus. It's anybody who hears the word. You're the you. And he's telling you to be born again. All your knowledge of Scripture, all your so-called good works, isn't going to do you any good whatsoever unless you're born again. Good works will not get you into heaven. That good works is something we should do. But Jesus said that God prepared the good works beforehand for us to do. But you've got to be born again first. And then you do the good works. Doing good works won't get you to heaven. Won't give you any brownie points with God. You won't be able to say, "Well, look what I did. I did this, I did that." And God will go, "Eh, so? Are you born again?" "No, not really." "Well, then, over there with you. Go with the goats. I want to be with the sheep." You see, being born again is not very complicated. We complicate Scripture terribly sometimes. Okay? If you read through the Old Testament, you see that God started off with, what did he start off with? 10 Commandments. Okay, and then when you read through that, you'll find that the Pharisees added hundreds of different things. Eating, washing, standing, doing all sorts of weird and wonderful things. But God kept it simple, and then we complicated it. And we made it so much that Jesus said to the Pharisees, you know, you're a bunch of hypocrites. You know, you're putting weights around people's necks, burdens upon people that they can't possibly uphold. They just can't possibly do anything. But it makes you feel good. But you're not doing anything for the people. And God keeps it very simple. This is what he says. John 1, or the first chapter of John 10 to 13. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God. To those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. All right, so being born again is simple. You believe in Jesus, you confess with your mouth, believe in your heart, you're born again. Simple. It's a very simple formula. Not complicated at all. But you've got to believe it. Okay? You can't just simply mouth platitudes. You just simply can't say these things and then not do them. All right? And I put my hand up for that, you know. You say things and then, you know, something crops up and you do something different. You know, my biggest failing, or not my biggest failing, but one of my failings is that when I'm driving my car, I suddenly become a different person. And roundabouts are my biggest mirror. And I can, yes, thank you, Jacqueline. I can be very abrupt with people that don't do roundabouts correctly. And you know, it's something that my wife slaps me down on. And you shouldn't say that. I went, oh, okay. Sorry, Lord. Bless that person. Forget what I just said, but just bless them. But see, so, you know, I mean, everybody is a work in progress. All right? Everybody is a work in progress. You are not perfect. And if anybody here thinks they're perfect, come and see me and I'll pray over you. Okay? Because we're not perfect. And Jesus knows we're not perfect, but he loves us. He loves us. He loves us so much that what did he do for us? He died on a cross. You know, what did he say to his disciples in Gethsemane? Don't you think that I could call on my Father and he would send, what was it, 20 legions? 12 legions, thank you, from the back there. I checked up on a legion once, and a legion is about 500 men. 5,000. I know there's five there somewhere. Thank you. Come down here. It was a lot. Okay, so 12 of them is an awful lot of people, a lot of angels. And even that is just a spit in the ocean. But he said, don't you think I can't do that? I could just call down all those thousands of angels. But he didn't. He went to the cross for you, for me, and for every person in this world. Acts 20 verse 21 says this, I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus. Repentance and faith in the Lord Jesus. That's how you get born again. And that's the most important thing. It's your choice. It's your choice. But you see, not everybody chooses the right way. Jesus came to his hometown, did he not? He'd done miracle upon miracle, And he came to his own town, and the scripture says they did not receive him. Isn't this Joseph? Isn't this Jesus, the son of Joseph the carpenter? What does he know? What does he know? And the scripture says that he could not do many miracles in that place. He obviously did a few, but not many, because people did not believe in him. And it's the same today, folks. If we're expecting miracles, then we need to believe in Jesus. If we don't believe in Jesus, then forget the miracles. It's not going to happen. You know, that's why when we come to church, be careful with my words, but when we come to church, we need to come with expecting hearts. Open hearts, but expecting hearts. You see, Jesus, the scripture says, is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Right? Jesus doesn't change. He hasn't suddenly gone on holiday. He hasn't pulled up stakes. He's the same. And he wants to do for us what he did back then. And we need to be open enough and willing enough to let the Spirit do what the Spirit can do. And, back in the 80s, I know we're all going backwards, but back in the 80s, we all saw some miraculous things. And we look now and we go, what happened? Well, the church got comfortable. We got set in our ways. You know, and we do it. We're a Pentecostal church, but we do it. We have our three songs and we have our announcements, and then we have our communion, and then we have another three songs, and then somebody gets up and brings a message and then says, coffee's out the back, and we all go home. Do we not? But what happens if the Spirit says, sing four songs? Oh, heaven forbid. We can't sing four songs. We've never done it that way. Well, so what? Let's sing four songs. Let's sing five songs. Let's sing all of them. I love it when we have our worship service, when all we do is we sing songs of praise and worship to God. It is absolutely fantastic, because you can just feel the Spirit just pouring in and pouring over people, and it is beautiful. But then we go back to tradition. And, tradition has its place. You know, if it's used correctly, if it brings your mind to focus on Jesus, then tradition, okay. But if you're just doing it because that's always the way we've done it, then let's forget it. You know, there is heaps of evidence for the death and resurrection of Jesus. Heaps of evidence. Not only does the Bible tell us that, but there are, if you look into secular historians of the time, you can see mention of the name of Jesus. And you can see that the Bible talks about that when he died, there was a blackness over the earth. Well, when you read some of the historians, there was. It's not just the Bible saying it. Historians will also tell you that. You look it up, see. I've said it already, I won't keep harping on about it, but you know, you must accept Jesus to be born again. You must. It's like a contract, and I've spoken about my early foray into contracts. And it is a contract of sorts with Jesus. Jesus says, follow my commands. If you love me, do what I tell you. And then you get all this other stuff. So it's a contract, you know. It's a you do, I do, and, you know, it's a contract. It's a must. And it's essential that we understand our role in this contract. There's always takes two parties to form a contract, okay? You can't have a contract with yourself. Or you could try, but I don't know how that would work. You keep rewriting it every time you're stuffed up. You say, oh, well, change that clause. Don't like that clause. Let's get rid of it. But with Jesus, you can't do that. Jesus says, you do this, and this is what happens. This is what you get. So it's interesting. So we need to be repentant. We need to have a look at what we're doing, and this is a good time of the year for us to really, really look at what we do. Okay, so believe, repent, receive. It's as simple as that. It's your choice. Okay. It's your choice. God does not enforce his will on us. Okay. Sometimes I wish he would. It would be a lot simpler, perhaps. But God doesn't want robots. He doesn't want mindless individuals. He wants you. With all your faults, with all your failures, he wants you because he loves you. And then what we do is we try, okay? We try to become more like Jesus. And if we allow the Holy Spirit through this being born again experience to work in our lives, he will knock off the rough edges. You know, you look at a diamond. You know, and you look at it on somebody's finger and it's all nice and shiny and it looks beautiful and, you know, the bigger it is, the shinier it is and all that kind of stuff. But if you were to look at that diamond when it just got dug out of the ground, you'd go, huh, that don't look like much. It's rough. It's dull. Don't look like a diamond, but it is. But then when the jeweler gets to it and he cuts off the bits that are rubbish and he starts to polish it and it starts to shine. It changes, doesn't it? All of a sudden, there's a gleam in it. There's a luster in it. And you see things in it that you never saw before. And this is what Jesus does to you. He grabs hold of you by the scruff of the neck sometimes and my hand's up for that. You've got to be grabbed by the scruff of the neck sometime, kicking and screaming. But he grabs a hold of you and then he cuts off the rough stuff. And he gets rid of it. Goes away. And then he starts to polish you. And then you start to shine. And you gleam. And all of a sudden, you're different. You're different. Did the diamond do much? No, the diamond just sat there on his little, whatever the thing is, that the jeweler uses. It just sat there, peaceful, quiet, and the jeweler got to work. And that's what Jesus does to you. He does the work, you sit there and receive. But you got to let Jesus do the work. If the diamond suddenly decided, oh, I don't like this, I'm getting off this pedestal and I'm going somewhere else, well, then it's a flawed, isn't it? Never gets finished. It's flawed. It's not good. But we're all diamonds in this place. You're all shining. Oh, I've already said that bit. You can't get into heaven by your good works. See, the Holy Spirit accomplishes in you and me what Paul wrote about in 2 Corinthians 5:17. It says this, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new, or are becoming new. You're a new creation. The old you is gone. The old diamond bits have all gone. They're in the trash. They've disappeared. And you're a new diamond. You're shining for God. Okay. We're all in God's family. And this is what 1 Peter 1, verse 3 has to say. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart, for you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living, enduring word of God. You know, the Bible tells us that, you know, people will know that you are followers of Christ by your love for one another. Okay. This church is a family. And families, unfortunately, have their ups and downs. But one thing about a family, or should be about a family, is that you can rely on them when you are in trouble. If you need help, then your family is there to give you help. Oh, we all have our difference of opinions. We all have our own thoughts and what have you on things. No family is perfect. As I said, we're not perfect. Nobody's perfect. But you can rely on family when you need to. And you should be able to rely on this family when you need to. But the thing is that if you don't ask for help, you won't get help. As yet, I have not developed the capacity to read people's minds. You'll all be grateful for that, I'm sure. I don't know what you're thinking. Right now, you could be saying, I wish you'd shut up. Or you could be saying, this is the best thing since sliced bread. I don't know. But whatever it is, as a family, if you want help, you need help, you come and you ask for it. And as a family, we should all be too happy to help, to do whatever it is necessary to get you through. Because life is tough. It's not easy. And if you're out there doing it on your own, it's even harder. What's the old saying? A problem shared is a problem halved. Something along those lines. If you need help, then you just speak about it. You know, right from day one, when God created the earth and the heavens and animals and all those sort of things, right from Genesis 1, God had a plan for the humankind. And that plan was resolved in Jesus. By his death and resurrection on the cross, the plan that God had to reconcile us to him was fulfilled. There is only one way. I keep saying it. There's only one way to heaven. There's only one way to the Father. And that is through Jesus Christ our Lord. There is no other way. Nothing will get you there. I don't care if you are the richest person in the world. Debate on that, whether it's Elon Musk or Vladimir Putin or somebody. But I don't care how much money you've got. I don't care how many followers you've got on Twitter or Facebook or any of those things. None of that is going to get you anywhere. You can't take your money to heaven. I remember this joke. I don't tell jokes very well, so you don't have to laugh. But yeah. It's a joke about this rich man. And he died. Okay, and he was going to heaven. So he rocks up to the gate. Now, I don't know whether there's a gate or not, but he rocks up to St. Peter at the gate. And he's carrying bags. And Peter says, oh, what's in the bags? And the guy opens the bags and it's gold. Bars of gold. And Peter said, you want to bring them in here? He said, yeah, if I can't bring them in, he said, I'm not coming in. He said, Peter said, well, okay, but what are you bringing road pavings for? You read the book of Revelation. The New Jerusalem, the road is paved in gold. God uses gold just for walking on. We use it as the most precious thing going. People hoard it. God uses it as road pavings. See, if you've already received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then you can take a moment to rejoice in that good news. If Jesus is your Lord and Savior, then you can say hallelujah. But if you don't know Jesus, now's a good time to get to know him. His arms are open, he's willing, he's never, ever gonna reject you, okay? I don't care what you've done. I don't care how miserable you feel. I don't care how awful you think your life is or what awful things you may have done. But if you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, all that can be changed. All of it. And you can know peace. And you can know the love of God in your heart. And you can be certain beyond all doubt that you are going to heaven. You just have to accept him. Now is a good time to do it. And if you are away from the Lord, if you've known the Lord before and you, for some reason, and COVID has caused a lot of people to question their faith and question what God's up to. But God doesn't bring bad things. My Bible says that every good gift comes down from the Father of lights, who is with no shadow of turning. God doesn't change, okay? So good things come from God. Bad things come from that other guy. We don't want that. We want good things. So if you want your life to be changed, you want your life to turn around, then you need to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Simple as that. So as we finish, let's just all take a moment. Look inside yourselves, okay? You know, the best person to judge you is you. Okay? You know you. I mean, God knows you better than you know you, but you know you. You know where you stand. You know the things that you need to say to God, oh, I'm sorry for. Help me, Lord. You know, some things are very difficult to get out of one system. Some things are so ingrained in us that it's almost like second nature. And God says, I want to get rid of that. And sometimes we just want to hang on to it. Because it's second nature to us. We feel comfortable in that. And God says, no, I want to get rid of it. I want it to go. I need it gone out of your life. And now's a good time to reflect on what God is talking to you about. See, if you come into church, or anywhere for that matter, as long as if you're born again, you can talk to God, I don't care where. in your car, work, grocery shopping. I don't care where you are. If you're born again and have the Spirit of God in you, you can talk to God anywhere, anytime, 24/7. God doesn't have a, you know, if I want to see the doctor, I've got to book 2 weeks in advance. Or maybe longer. But if I want to talk to God, I can just say, Lord, are you there? I know you're there. I want to talk to you. I got a problem. This, that, and the other. Help me, Lord. Show me how. Show me. Show me how to get rid of that. What's in my life that shouldn't be there? And if we're fair dinkum, that's another good Australian saying. I'm getting better with my Australian sayings. I should do after almost 60 years living here. I should be coming good with those, but I'm still having trouble. But if we're fair dinkum, then God is fair dinkum. And God will meet you and show you and help you. And you can change. You will change if you allow the Holy Spirit to work in you. And even if you've gone away from Him, He hasn't gone away from you. He hasn't left you. He hasn't forsaken you. He's still there. You just need to reach out. Speak to Him and He will speak to you. So, I hope I've done Wayne's message the best I can. We have our Sunday service and I'm preaching again on Sunday, so that will be written by yours truly and hopefully finished today, hopefully. We'll see how we go. That's another one of my sort of failings. I tend to leave things to the last moment. But I usually get there through the grace of God. I'm going to fall over my shoelace if I keep doing this. So let's all just take a moment, stand up, praise God. And my Lord, I just let me just pray a prayer over everybody and then we'll go and have coffee. Well, thank you, Lord. I thank you for the people that have arrived today, Lord. Thank you for the people, Lord God, that are watching by camera, Lord, on Facebook and wherever else. Oh, I just pray, Lord God, that you, Father, would be real to them today, Lord. That your presence, Lord God, would be upon them, Lord God, that your favor would be with everyone, Lord. That they would know your blessings in their life, Lord. I just thank you, Father God, for the opportunity, Lord, to come today to celebrate, Lord God, the death of Jesus and our rebirth through that, Lord. So we just thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name. Amen. So, thank you, folks. I think the tea and coffee's available. So if you want have a chat with people, just have a chat. Don't run away. Just say hello. Wish somebody a happy Easter. See you on Sunday.